Okay, so this is the second session of the DSA Austin Intro to the Labor Movement. A few quick preliminaries, which I'll skip through very quickly this time since we did them last time. My name is Joshua Fries. I spent the last 30 or so years in the labor movement, mostly as a rank and file activist, occasionally as a local officer, as an organizer in Amalgamated Transit Union 1549 here in Austin and 1005 up in the Twin Cities, AFA, that's the Association of Flight Attendants, Council 70 in Philadelphia, a short amount of time in AFSCME Local 25, driving a bus just outside of Detroit, and a good number of years in the IWW as well. Unions are a tool. A lot of liberal and left material makes us out to be victims. Unions are the instrument that the working class uses to change ourselves from passive observer of the world into the active driver. So why are we doing this? Because you cannot defeat capital without labor. More specifically, because there's a great deal of interest in the branch, but because there aren't a whole lot of unions in Texas, there's not as much experience as there is interest. So this is sort of a quick and dirty, here's what unions do, and you'll spend the rest of your life learning the rest. 4 weeks. Last week, we did an intro to how unions work and what they do. This week, we're talking about the private sector, labor law, and DSA organizers. Next week, same thing with the public sector. And finally, in a couple of weeks from now, we'll look at a short history of leftist strategies with respect to labor and a beginning, well, actually a continuation, to be fair. It's not like it's just starting now, in the Austin DSA labor strategy for the future. Some technical things. This is in the place of Red Square, but it is not exactly Red Square. This is more presentation and less discussion, so apologies ahead of time for that. This is just about labor. We will just be talking about the labor movement here. Because there's less time for discussion, I would ask that you limit questions and comments to a minute or so, so more of your comrades can participate as well. Chat will be turned off during the presentation. It's very distracting. Likewise, please mute yourself during the presentation and whenever you don't have the floor during the discussion section. All right. So, US labor law. First, a quick distinction. There is something called labor law and there is employment law. Employment law is generally individual. It's things like the Fair Labor Standards Act saying you have to get the minimum wage. You get overtime after 40. It includes various civil rights laws that say you can't be discriminated against for race or religion and such things, workers' comp laws, workplace safety laws, child labor regulations, et cetera. Those are interesting and important, and we worked hard for those, but it's not what labor law is. Labor law is about collective workers' action. There's four major private sector labor laws, four. Sorry, I'm looking, I can't count anymore. The National Labor Relations Act, more commonly known as the Wagner Act in 35, Taft-Hartley Act, which I've never heard anybody call the Labor Management Relations Act of 1947, but that's the proper name. Landrum-Griffin, also occasionally called LMRDA, which is not very poetic, but is short for Labor Management Reporting and Disclosure Act in the 59, the considerably older Railway Labor Act of 26, and public sector, which we'll talk about next week. The Wagner Act. This was passed under Franklin Delano Roosevelt. It basically made it legal for most workers to join unions, to organize unions, and to collectively bargain. I say most because it excludes agricultural workers. So if you work on a farm or a ranch or anything like that, you don't count. Just like you don't count for minimum wage laws. Same thing for domestic workers, contractors, family members, governments. Of course, workers are of course covered by public sector labor law, and it didn't cover railroads and labor lines. Because the airlines got dumped into the Railway Labor Act in the mid-30s. The Wagner Act created the NLRB, that's National Labor Relations Board, to hear charges because it made it illegal for employers to discriminate or interfere with unions and union activists. It defined something called a ULP, an unfair labor practice, which created a list of things that employers can't do with regard to unions. Unfortunately, there was no real punishment. So here's what happens if an employer violates your union rights. You're organizing a union and your employer fires you. You go to the District National Labor Relations Board. The board says, you're right, and tells your employer, hire him back, pay him what he owes, pay him for his lost wages. The employer says no and appeals it to the regional level. So some months have gone by now. And the regional board says the same thing. And the employer says no and appeals it to the federal NLRB. And the same thing happens. So some more months have gone by, right? You're either getting hungry or you've got another job by now. So you go to the national NLRB and the employer says no. And it goes, and so they then have the right to appeal to the district federal court. So you see where this is going, right? And then they can appeal to the appellate courts. In theory, they can go to the Supreme Court, probably not going to be accepted. But we're talking a lot of months and probably a few years if they actually go the whole nine yards on that. So in the meantime, you've probably gotten another job, which is good for you because you like to eat. But here's what happens. You're legally entitled to your lost pay for all that time minus every dollar you earned in the meantime. So that's probably going to come out to a whole lot of nothing. And the employer knows that. This is because the Wagner Act was not designed to protect you as a worker. It was designed to protect commerce by reducing strikes. There was a lot of labor action in the 20s and 30s in this country. The IWW and later CP, Communist Party led unions, there was a lot of militancy, there was a lot of strikes, there was a lot of fighting capital, and not too long before, right, 20 years before the Wagner Act in 1917, the Russians got totally sick of the Tsar and had a little revolution. This made capitalists very nervous everywhere, including in the United States. So the smart capitalists said to the dumb capitalists who just wanted to keep fucking with workers, we've got to give them something, and we've got to give them a tool that ties them to capitalism. And the tool was bureaucratic unions. And to some degree, it worked. But we got some good things out of it. It did become easier to organize unions, and that's a big plus. And even though we didn't get everything we wanted, this was a victory in a way. So 12 years later, capital decides we've had enough good luck. Taft-Hartley was passed. Taft-Hartley was a wholesale undercutting of the Wagner Act. It added union ULPs, unfair labor practices. So if you look at that list there, you'll notice an awful lot of strikes and picketings and boycotts. The things that are our tools were made illegal. All of the most powerful kinds of strikes were made illegal. It also banned closed shops. What's a closed shop? A closed shop is where you have to be in the union to get the job in the first place. It also allowed states to ban union and agency shops. A union shop is similar to a closed shop, but you have to join within a few, maybe a month after getting the job. And an agency shop is a lot suckier. It says you don't have to join the union, but you have to pay something called agency fees to a union. So in places like Texas, you don't have to do any of that. Right-to-work states like Texas, and we talked about this last week, mean that the union has to do everything for you and you don't have to join the union. You can see why this is a problem. Moving on, union officers were required to sign non-communist affidavits. Basically, they're trying to gut the radical leadership of the unions. It overturned the demand for employer neutrality in the Wagner Act. So someone who was thinking far ahead during the Wagner Act might have thought, well, wait a minute, if they can't talk shit about the union, how did all that happen in Alabama with Amazon? And that's because Taft-Hartley overturned that requirement. And this was the clause that permitted companies to go to town with captive audience meetings and the various other ways they tried to fight unions. It also gave courts the power to hold unions financially liable. So any of those strikes you see up there, if a union launches one of those, but if they don't work hard enough to convince the courts that they're trying to force their members back to work, if their members are doing it themselves, they can be held financially liable. And I put pro-arbitration in there because it basically made it much harder for unions to take their own actions rather than relying on arbitration, which is to say lawyers to solve their problems for them. Landrum-Griffin Act. There's two bits of this. One is turns out to be a good bit, which is probably an accident, and the other is a wholesale bad bit. The good bit is the union members often called a Bill of Rights. Landrum Griffin says unions have to hold secret ballot elections. That means if you have a thuggish union president, they don't get to know how you voted. It guaranteed a minimum level of free speech and freedom from abuse in unions from officers. So this is good, right? You think of mobbed up unions, it's good that you have some rights. Unions also have to submit annual financial reports to the Department of Labor. So that doesn't sound like that great a thing, but if you're in a crappy union with a bunch of crappy, corrupt officers who are, or just lazy officers, this makes it very easy for you to go to the Department of Labor site and in a minute or two, find out all of their salaries that they're getting from the union and how much they are, you know, and how much their expense reports were. So when you're trying to convince your fellow workers to overturn a terrible union leadership, it can be really helpful if you come in with a number like, why is he making 5 or 10 or 20 times what we do? How does he have anything in common with us? It's a very useful tool. Landrum Griffin also limited the ability for parent unions to trustee locals. The reason for trustees in theory is for things like corruption. You know, if union officers are stealing money, then the national can step in and trustee them until things are fixed. Unfortunately, this usually ends up working the other way. SEIU was well known for trusteeing unions that are engaging in too much democracy and militancy. Unfortunately, Landrum Griffin didn't do enough to limit trusteeship to prevent that. It put some rules in place for disciplining and expelling members. That's good. It's good to have some legal rights. Yep. It only covers, Landrum Griffin, that is, only covers the Wagner Act and Railway Labor Act unions, not generally public sector. So TSU and ASPE folks, sorry, we're not covered. The really bad side of Taft-Hartley was it strengthened the bad parts, of Landrum Griffin, is it strengthened the bad parts of Taft-Hartley. It, you know, made it even harder for, well, it basically strengthened the ban on Communist Party members. This was ruled unconstitutional in 1965. So even though some unions still have clauses in their constitution or bylaws, they can't actually enforce them against communists or members of DSA. It strengthened Taft-Hartley's secondary boycott provisions, prohibited some hot cargo agreements. Hot cargo agreements are the fundament of union-union solidarity. So if I work in a factory and you drive a truck and my factory is on strike and you have a good hot cargo agreement, you can say, we're not gonna haul that. None of us are gonna haul that. Some of those, but not all kinds of hot cargo agreements were prohibited under the bad part of Landrum Griffin. Finally, it allows the board, the National Labor Relations Board, to stop your pickets after 30 days if you haven't filed for an election. As you may remember from last week, there's two basic ways to get union recognition. One is to file an election with the NLRB, and the other is to, through worker power, force the boss to negotiate with you. Obviously, the second is harder and much more powerful. This intent is to push you into the less powerful version of filing an election and turning your power over to lawyers. Okay, stepping back a few years to the Railway Labor Act. Covers railroad workers. In the 30s, the airlines workers were added, and FedEx. So when FedEx was founded, it was in significant part an airline package company with some truck drivers who did it the last mile. And they managed to keep a lot of that. Some of their slowboat ground workers are under the Wagner Act, but even their huge bank of drivers who pick up stuff from the airport and take it to wherever it's going to go are covered by the Railway Labor Act. So the reason that's important is because it's much harder to organize under the RLA than under the NLRA. Under the Wagner Act, you can organize one shop at a time until you have an employer everywhere. Under the Railway Labor Act, you have to organize everywhere at once, the entire country. Obviously, we want to get there, but it does make it a lot, it's a lot steeper barrier to entry than in the Wagner, under Wagner Act industries. It also makes it much harder to strike. It does, however, make it much harder to replace strikers. So if you're on strike and the company hires a bunch of scabs, it's pretty hard for your boss to say, we're not going to take you back. They pretty much have to. And at least as important is the restrictions on strike types are much reduced. Intermittent and secondary, all kinds of solidarity strikes are permitted. But in this picture, you see there are the Alaska Airlines flight attendants in 1993. And they invented what they called chaos, which was creating havoc around our system. In the airlines, most of the revenue doesn't come from you flying home to see grandma or your girlfriend or whatever once a year. Most of the revenue comes from business travelers because they buy expensive last minute tickets and they have to be there now. And they read the business press. And the business press reports when there's labor strife at a company. So when AFA said, we're going to occasionally strike a flight and we're not going to tell you which one it is. It's just not going to go because you can't fly the plane without us. Business travelers can't handle that. Half of them left. And overnight, Alaska's revenue was just cut to the bone. The flight attendants ended up with the richest contract in the industry. And it wasn't even a major carrier. It's a second tier carrier. And it's nowhere near the size of what was then, you know, the major six carriers. And they took Alaska to the cleaners and got an incredible contract. The moral of the story is, of course, think about your strategy. Where's your employer weak? And that's where you hit them. An all out stay out strike sounds exciting, but it's often not the right strategy. Okay, so that's the labor law part. Moving on to actual organizing. Most of labor work is organizing. If you don't have a union, you got to organize to get one. That's called external organizing. If you already got one, then that doesn't mean you're done. It just means you've got to keep organizing in a different way. You have to keep members involved. You have to keep building strength and make it stronger. In Texas, you have to convince people not to leave the union because they can do that and get all the same rights, and convince people who are out to join. That's internal organizing. So we talked before many times about the separation between socialism and unions. If we want to win, we've got to build the bridge to connect the two sides. We've got to connect unions to socialism, and we've got to connect socialists to unions. Half of the strategy is pretty clear, right? Socialists got to get their tails into union jobs. You know, you organize your job or get a job where there's a union. Okay, that's pretty obvious. We'll talk about the more complicated part. We're going to lay that on Paul in a little bit. Sorry, Paul. So, first, we're going to open up a panel with a couple of local DSA leading external organizers, Chris Himmelblau with the Restaurant Organizing Project and Matt Dragomanovich with the Emergency Workplace Organizing Committee. I'm going to introduce you to those organizations just quickly. So the ROP was created by DSA's Democratic Socialist Labor Commission to teach chapters how to organize laid off restaurant workers and set up organizing campaigns that can fight for relief in the short term and, you know, organize a longer term vision to reshape the industry. EWOC it's a joint project between DSA and the UE, the United Electrical Workers. This is from their text, so pardon my reading, uses distributive organizing techniques and a mass volunteer base to provide support and training to non-union workers, focusing on developing workplace issue fights and supporting leadership development. So a brief introduction to UE, United Electrical, Radio and Machine Workers of America, to give their full name. This is one of the most democratic, militant, and strategy-minded unions in the US. It's rare among US unions in that they actually build international alliances, probably most importantly with the FAT, the Authentic Labor Front, a democratic union federation in Mexico that's opposed to the often corrupt and cooperative with capital CTM, the older federation. UE was originally part of the CIO, but left rather than agree to purge the Reds in the union. The CIO actually went so far as to create a new outfit, the IUE, International Union of Electrical Workers, with the intent of raiding the UE out of existence. Fortunately, they failed. The UE and the IUE fought for years. They work together a little bit better now, especially places like General Electric, where they have joint contracts, or where they both have contracts. So I'm going to quit sharing. And move some screens around here. So we're going to start with EWOC and ROP. So Chris and Matt will be our contestants. So let me start. I'm going to go back and forth between them. Most of the questions are to both of them, and so I'll let one of them answer, and then the other one can fill in if there's something that he'd like to answer. And then a couple at the end, one for each of them that's just about their organization. So let's start with Matt. In any organizing campaign, an early necessity is to identify leaders, you know, workers in the shop who will push to evaluate other workers and push others on the job to the next level of commitment. What sort of traits and skills do you look for, and what might make you shy away from someone?
Yeah, absolutely. So we look for, or EWOC emphasizes looking for what they call organic leaders. Again, this isn't necessarily someone who has an official role or any sort of official power, but someone who is respected by their coworkers, someone that, you know, you'll see them turning to, that's usually on a good terms with most of the workers there, you know, gets along and is usually a good worker. Typically for the ones that you're going to shy away from, this is going to be, you know, usually someone that is complaining a lot. You know, you might like, oh, this person's mad at the boss, and get them on side. But usually if they're that outspoken, you know, they might not be too interested in trying to improve it. Also, ones that I try and shy away from are people that sort of act like bosses, or, you know, are trying to pretend or climb a lot. Or also ones that are just looking out for themselves. Like on my shop, I have a guy who he's constantly pretending as if he is a boss, and he like leaves and doesn't help us close and stuff like that, right? So that's someone I'm not really gonna be looking out for. Chris, you have anything to add?
Yeah, everything you just said. So you're looking for like organic leaders. I think Labor Notes calls them informal leaders, but just like workers and your coworkers they have like an issue, they need advice, they need someone to like stand up for them, they'll go to them because they respect this worker and they trust this worker. And those are the people you want on your side. Those are the people that you need on your side if you're going to have a successful campaign. They're typically the hardest workers, and that's why they're so well respected. And that, of course, like it comes with a caveat with kind of with whenever you're like trying to identify who's going to be on your campaign. Because if they've been in the shop for a while, they may have like a rapport with the management. So you'll want to like, you know, suss out what that relationship is. In the service industry, what we teach organizers with the Restaurant Workers United, which is like a DSA Unite Here coalition, is we encourage organizers to go to like social outings. Like when you're working at a restaurant, like after your shifts at like end at 10 or 11 or 12, you go to bars. You could go to a bar and see what relationships are going on. You could see who's friends with who. You could start like the mental mapping and the relationship mapping. And it's a great place to get to know your coworkers better and kind of get the climate of the shop as well.
Great. So Chris, when worker organizers approach their uninvolved coworkers, what are a couple of the most important elements that you heard for a first conversation that you encourage them to hit?
Find out what they care about. You shouldn't approach the conversation like you're interrogating them. Like just, you know, like, hey, how are you doing? How are you? Like, has, I don't know, just open-ended questions that could lead them to find out if they have a problem with what's going on. You could even ask, like, how long have you worked here again? And it's really important to find out what they care about. And you're doing the listening. In these organizing conversations, the rule of thumb is 80-20 or 70-30. You're listening 80% of the time and you're talking 20% of the time.
Want to add anything to that, Matt?
Yeah, I was gonna say, I mean, I would really can't emphasize enough the listening and asking questions part. Learning what they care about, learning what's important to them, you know, learning about what's going on in their life, you know, issues that they're having and how that might relate to work. And I would just kind of add to that, asking the questions is a great way to also start empowering the workers. Because if you just say, hey, work sucks, like we should have a union, like we should start a union, I think a lot of times they just hear, hey, work sucks, you should do something about it. Like you should start doing this thing rather than, you know, and then they're kind of like, well, I don't want to do any more work, you know? But if it's along the lines of, you know, I'll be at work and we have to stay late a lot of times past what the shift is. And, you know, a coworker will be complaining about it or I'll kind of complain about it. And I'll say, why is this? Why do we have to stay late? Like, why don't we have enough people here? You know, and then they'll kind of start to think about it themselves in ways that they hadn't, right? They'll say like, yeah, why don't they hire more people? Like, what is going on? Like, why do I have to work this hard? And then you can kind of keep that going for them to find that power by saying, hey, how could we change this? What could we do so that they do hire enough people or so that they do pay us more or we do have control over our schedule? And once they feel that empowerment, they're going to be a lot more likely to, you know, they're going to come up with their own ideas. They're going to be a lot more likely to sign on to any action that you might be looking to lead as well.
So talk a little about inoculation, not the COVID kind, but what does it mean in the context of union organizing? And what are a few vital things that we should warn our coworkers about going into this?
Yeah, so inoculation is usually tied to when you're gonna start doing action, right? So for example, you know, maybe you don't have enough PPE or maybe you wanna change something about the workplace and you've talked to everybody, you got people on board and you're deciding, hey, we're gonna do a petition or we're going to do a strike or whatever the action is that you're going to do, you want to lead all of the workers and try and inoculate against that fear as well as address it, right? Face it head on so that everybody is prepared for it. Nobody's taken aback. You're not caught by surprise. So it's a really vital part of that process. Again, it's done by asking questions, right? It's, you know, let's say we're going to do a petition and we're going to march into the boss and say, hey, we demand that you provide everybody with masks at the beginning of the shift, or hey, we want, you know, whatever it is that your demand is. You're going to talk to each worker who's going to be involved in it. You're going to say, what do you think the boss is going to do when we present these demands? How are they going to react? What are they going to feel like? And so again, it gets them thinking about what's going to happen, what's, you know, how might they react? And then they can prepare for how they're going to react, right? So then you're not caught off guard. So not only do you kind of inoculate against that fear, but it also allows you to develop a strategy to deal with whatever that response is.
Chris?
Yeah, I think inoculation is kind of one of the most important like support beams in a successful campaign. So I like what Matt said, you're informing your coworkers of the possible retaliation that they will like, they will act on when people are organizing, unless you have a dumbass boss, which most bosses are, but you know, they're not all magnanimous. So it's like awesome if you could get your coworkers enthusiastic and on board to organize, but if you don't caution them, like of the incoming shit slinging from the bosses, you're setting up your campaign for failure. And though it may like, at first seem a little counterintuitive to scare your coworkers that your bosses are going to do some depraved retaliatory actions and tactics. Like just look at what Amazon did, like hold your boss to that standard of shittiness. And the workers and your coworkers who are still on board after you tell them that, and after they internalize that it's going to be an ugly fight, then that means they're going to be more immune to those retaliations. And it'll also boost your credibility and your trust with them when that happens. They're like, wow, you know, they were right. Like, it'll just make your organizing committee and your campaign stronger for it.
So in both the major organizing campaigns that I was involved in, I noticed a real tendency to overestimate people's level of support. Why is it important to properly assess people in the first place and talk about the risks of over and underestimating the support that an initial organizing campaign has?
So I think Jane McAlevey did a really good job pointing this out as one of the the death blows of the Bessemer campaign, is that they really overestimated their support. So like when you're assessing support, you use like an arbitrary scale. So like say it's like 1 to 5 and 1 is you the most supportive and 5 is like they're totally against the union. So you want to continually update these assessments of your coworkers because the climate changes. And so throughout the campaign, before you even like, or when you go, when you take the campaign live, if you have found out like, yeah, that we have enough people, you haven't overestimated, you underestimated, it seems like it's gonna work out. Apathy attrition still like happen, and your campaign will lose support. Like I've heard multiple anecdotes from like workers who were enthusiastic about unions. I've heard an anecdote where a worker was like an avowed socialist, but they called it quits because of how draining the morale can be when there isn't enough support. And so you have to go into the campaign realizing that there's gonna be a lot of people who drop off of it. So you need to start at a very high percentage before you even take it live.
Yeah, I was gonna add a little bit on like why I think it happens too, and kind of ways that you can avoid it. And I think, you know, in terms of if we're thinking about no shortcuts, like one of the biggest shortcuts you can take is not actually talking to your coworkers and having that connection and asking questions. And it's not just once, it's talking with them all the time, right? And it is really hard. And at first it doesn't seem hard, but I've literally walked into my shop telling myself, hey, I'm gonna talk to 3 coworkers today and I'm gonna try and do a little agitation question. And I'll literally go to open my mouth and, you know, it doesn't come out or whatever, right? And because it's scary and you have to be vulnerable and it's a difficult thing. And so it's much easier just to say, oh yeah, I heard, you know, Matt, you know, talking shit about the workplace. I'm sure he's on board. He supports us, you know, and then you don't have to have that conversation with them. You don't have to keep having that conversation with them.
Oops. Did Matt just freeze for everybody else? Okay. Well, Chris, let's see. I think I started that one with you, right? Okay, well, let's give Matt's internet time to catch up, but we're going to keep on moving on, and hopefully Matt will rejoin us in a second. So Chris, I've often noticed that people can have no connection between their union politics and their politics with everything else that the left holds dear. How would you go about recruiting a worker who has problems with the job, seems like a good candidate for the union, but leans right on social issues and sees the union as some bastion of liberalism, but likes the idea of union, you know, of the union as a union.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's, I mean, even just like putting union organizing aside, like it's good as socialists to remind ourselves not to like get ourselves ensnared of the intellectual muck that is like political culture war. it really kind of like obfuscates what the class war that is actually going on. And so, you know, whether your coworker considers themselves like left or right on the American political spectrum, if they're your coworker, they have similar material needs that you do, and they have a stake in this system, a very similar stake that you do. So you shouldn't assume, you should also shouldn't assume they're like views based on a cursory glance, because like, what if they're like this person that, you know, has Elizabeth Warren's like hex tile tattooed on their arm. You shouldn't assume that they're like into unions. So it's talking to them on a class level, not on a level of you know, Democrats and Republicans. We know not to do that, but it's kind of like baked into our brains to kind of analyze and process things that way. So just like talking to them, like, you're a worker, I'm a worker, we need to do what's good for all workers. And unions are really the only way you can do that, in collective power and collective bargaining.
I think Matt has rejoined us.
I have, yeah, sorry about that, my internet.
Oh yeah, internet troubles happen. So we're just talking about how you deal with someone who seems like they're, you know, could be convinced to be involved in the union, but leans right in other areas.
Yeah, absolutely. I think like Chris was saying, again, if you've done the initial work where, hey, you've actually talked to this person, you know what their concerns are, you know what's going on with them. And not only that, but you've done that work to sort of make them feel empowered, right? If they start to see, oh, this is why my job is so shitty, this is why I'm not able to get the pay I need, or whatever, or where it's not safe here at work, or whatever it is. If you've done that, and it's this, like Chris was saying, very real material thing to their life, it's a lot easier to spur them to action over that than it is that idealism part of it, you know, just some sort of conception they have of it. And so, and then from there too, I think once you've stood in solidarity with someone and you've struggled together and won something, right, it's a lot easier for them to join some other fight, which maybe doesn't necessarily have that material basis or that very strict material connection to them.
Great, thanks. So Chris, this is kind of getting into the nitty gritty of this. All workplaces have built-in conflicts, right? Between workers, not just between us and the bosses, because, you know, any workplace that has more than one kind of job, there's probably some way that people grade on each other. I've, except for when I was in the air, haven't really done food service, but everybody I know who's ever worked or organized in the industry talks about this distinction between the front and the back of the house in restaurants. Talk about some ways the ROP deals with that.
Yeah, so this is a huge, huge like topic, and we could do a whole series on this. But yeah, the front of house and back of house is a massive, there is a division of labor and there that is felt by everyone. Like racial lines are very clearly divided in this front and back of house. How wage and it works typically. So one of the fucked up things about like tip versus wage is the whole system is based on the restaurant owner is putting the entrepreneurial risk on of like how much your servers get paid onto the servers themselves. So for, you know, back of house, you're getting an hourly wage. So if it's busy or if it's slow, you're getting paid the same. So of course, back of house, they prefer it slow. Front of house, it's the opposite. Like if it's slow, front of house workers don't get any money. They need to feed themselves because they're getting their whole paychecks based on tips. And then they want it to be busy so they can get, you know, higher tips. And that does cause some tension between the two, because it's really great when you're making $800 a night in tips, but if you're a cook, if you're a line cook, and on one of those nights, you're fucking miserable. So that's one of the things that, like, it's kind of hard right now as it is to kind of address those tensions, other than like kind of political education around unions and bringing up class consciousness and understanding kind of like how capitalism works. And it's tough. It's a big question. But our goals for this, our campaigns for this last year have served in two ways. Like, first was obviously to help and reach out to workers that are in need and trying to bring more workers into the project. And the second is, of course, building trust with the service industry community in Austin and kind of abroad with the other chapters in ROP National. Because of course, like, if they don't trust us and they have no idea who we are and what we stand for, like, why would they respond to us reaching out? So building trust has been a huge thing this past year. And we've been pretty smart about making our campaigns public facing, because we've received a lot of attention. And Crystal and Gina have been like amazing at that. Crystal is like, she was just published in the Post, or a quote was published in the Post. So that's pretty awesome. Yeah. I hope that answered the question.
Yeah, no, that's good. I mean, obviously it's a long question. There's not, you know, an answer, but, you know, at least get started and sort of shows how a union organizer would deal with a complex issue. So Matt, I know a little bit about UE, and I'm guessing EWOC, because of their influence, talks about a minority union strategy before you ever achieve recognition. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, so EWOC, we don't explicitly call it a minority union strategy, because one of the unique things about EWOC was it is built around building worker power and like we said, developing leadership, right? So it's not necessarily, its goal isn't always to even form a union. It started at the beginning of the pandemic and sort of out of this need to help workers win safety and protection, in large part due to COVID. So we're very much focused on, this is worker driven and shop floor driven, right? So it depends on the needs of that particular workplace, and where they want to take that campaign also depends on them, right? So a lot of cases you might be talking to someone, and especially early in the pandemic, it was, hey, we want PPE, we want restrictions on the space in the store and things like that. They might rally their workers around that, do a petition, win that change, and, you know, that's the end of that campaign. But they've won those protections, they've sort of built that leadership up, they've started to flex that muscle. And then if they want to take it to a union campaign from there, they can. So I think, like, the minority union strategy, as far as EWOC is concerned, is we are looking to win worker power, however that looks like, right? Specifically around safety, and then kind of building from there. So, and I know, like, I think with UE and UAW did a similar thing in Kentucky, I think, right, where it's, even if you don't have a union, even if you don't have a contract or representation, looking to develop strategies where workers can still get wins, they can still get their demands met, and shaping their strategy around that. And so that's really kind of that core is finding those first issues that are widely and deeply felt, and then developing a strategy based on the actual conditions in that shop to win some demands, particularly around safety for those workers.
Great. Yeah, that's exactly how I sort of heard that used. I mean, they use that phrase, but the idea of just fighting now and not waiting for some future date when you have recognition, right? But, hold on just a second while I do some little technical bureaucracy here. Okay, so much great thanks to Chris and Matt. That was fantastic. So I talked earlier about the bridge between socialism and unions and how half the strategy is fairly obvious, right? What Chris and Matt and Crystal and then are doing, you know, get in, build unions, join unions where there already are. The other half is not so clear though, how to move unions towards socialism, not just socialists toward unions. One way that people have done this before that hasn't been especially effective is what we jokingly call not revolutionary, but resolutionary socialism. This is the idea of bringing some radical motion to your union on something that may or may not have anything to do with this employer and this workforce. I'm not saying this is going to hurt anything, but it's not exactly clear how you're moving the union by just making a statement. More successfully, socialists have engaged in unions as schools of revolution, pushing the unions to take better, more action, because that's how most people become revolutionaries, is not by something they read by Marx or Bakunin or whoever, but through the struggle itself. But for this school to work, there has to be some level of militancy, some level of direct action in the union. The union has to actually be in struggle, and the membership has to be invested in the union, which means the members have to feel that ownership, which only comes with a high level of union democracy. So in considering a strategy to build that other half of the bridge, an important first consideration for socialists in unions is how to develop democracy and militancy. So my questions for Paul in the IBEW are geared to teasing out where the IBEW is now. So the rest of us have a sense of where DSA members and other militants in the union are starting from. Some of these are pointed questions. I want to make it clear, my intention is not to kick the IBEW. Quite the contrary, I want it to become a fighting, militant tool of the working class. But part of the process of developing socialist unions is developing a constructive criticism of the ways unions have drifted away from socialism over the last century. This is the process we'll use a couple of weeks from now when we're talking about what sort of strategies DSA Austin should be talking about for its labor work in the future. So, so again, I'm going to end sharing so we can see Paul's face. Did that work? Yes, I think so. So, all right, Paul, are you with us?
There we go. I am unmuted, hopefully.
Oh, there he is. Okay, yes, you're quiet, but you're there.
Cool. I'll just have to.
So some of these questions are going to seem a little bureaucratic, but that's because, you know, we're trying to figure out what can members do in the organization now in order to figure out how to push the organization. So talk some about meetings in the IBEW. You know, how often are meetings held? Are members informed ahead of time? Do they know the agenda? Are people encouraged to speak, or is it mostly just reports from officers? Sort of give us a sense of what a meeting looks like.
Yeah, so at least here in Local 520, our unions are held once a month. We inform our members mostly through the Trailblazer, but also like it's almost always the third Friday of a month. And if it's not, we'll send out an email or a text message about that.
What's the Trailblazer?
The Trailblazer, I'm sorry, is our local newsletter.
Okay.
But yeah, and so, but to the agenda, the item, that's something that I've been like talking with people a lot about. It's like, man, we don't have an agenda for our committee meetings. We don't have an agenda for our general body meetings, whatever. This local 520 is a little different, at least from what I hear about other building trades locals, where that we are actually pretty, you know, democratic in the sense that pretty much everybody has the chance to make their voices heard. on like almost every motion. Quite honestly, to my point, sometimes we should call the question more often.
People and understand that.
Yeah, we had a debate that went on for maybe like 40 minutes about t-shirts last Friday, which was just I wanted to deterritorialize.
Yeah.
But there's that, and then we have a section at the end which is for the good of the union, and basically anybody can bring anything to the floor that they would like. It's you get all kinds of crazy motions that get either shot down by different people or end up being unconstitutional or whatever, or sometimes they pass.
So. That actually sounds pretty good from my impression from other people I've known in building trades unions. It sounds like 520 is a step ahead for sure.
In that sense, yes. We'll get to some other questions where we have some problems.
So, when you have disagreements in meetings with all of these voices, I'm sure there are some, how do you resolve them?
Yeah, sure. So sometimes things can definitely get pretty heated. We had to actually remind members this meeting about how we were when you're making a comment, you are addressing the chair, not each other. So we aren't shouting at each other during a meeting. We try and follow Robert's rules, etc., to the extent that the chair remembers it, who is the president, Mike King at the moment. Yeah. And that's how those are resolved. You'll definitely get into shouting matches in the parking lot sometimes if something especially goes the wrong way for someone. But beyond that, it's pretty democratic.
On that subject of democracy, I mean, I assume the local officers and the business agents are elected. How often are elections in the IBEW? I assume that's actually a constitutional thing.
Yeah, so actually, I'm not sure if it's in, maybe it is in our constitution or something, but our elections are typically 3 years.
Okay.
And that's in line with how long our contracts are, which is interesting in some ways and confusing in others,
Do those line up? That is, are the elections just before or just after a contract?
Just before. So, you can get in the very unfortuitous situation where you might have a new business agent negotiating the next contract, which happened 3 years ago.
That's interesting. You have to think about that, what the fallout of that. So, I can't remember how long you've been in the local, but when there are elections, I mean, are they contested? Is there turnover in officers? Or is it pretty much whoever's there is going to be there next time too?
Yeah, so I have not actually been part of a leadership election yet. Our first election, my first elections are actually going to take place in August of this year. They can be pretty contested. But they aren't really contested along political lines is what I've been kind of sussing out from my coworkers. Very frequently, it's mostly resolved around, you should trust me. I'm a good brother and, I have good sense and that's why you should elect me. People don't run on a vision really of what our union should be doing, which is something that, as someone who's very reform-minded in this union, that's definitely something that like I would like to see in the future. Not now, but in the future, because that's going to take a very, very long time of raising consciousness, having one-on-one conversations with union members, etc.
Yeah. Do you have shop stewards?
We currently have six for 1,800 members. That alone is one of the things that I see that we can just do right now that would just make the union a much more present force in people's lives almost immediately.
Well, what do the stewards do? I guess I should have asked you to define those, since some folks might not know what that is.
Sure. So a steward is someone who is a representative of the union on the shop floor. They are the person who will accompany you if you are getting written up, or they'll basically stick up for you when management comes down on you. So, you know, you always, like, if you're late for some reason and your boss writes you up, you can say, you know, basically, hey, I'm not signing anything until my steward is present, and let's talk about it with the representative of the union here. And yeah, that's basically how that works.
Okay. That's a biggie though. I mean, the 6 for 1800 people, especially as dispersed as you guys are when you're out there on, you know, however many dozens, hundreds of job sites, I don't know, but lots. Right.
It's honestly, the only way to describe it is a travesty.
Yeah.
It's the, you know, you talk with these other unions in, you know, New York City, or, you know, even places like Omaha. And it's like, what are you talking about? I have a steward on my shop, even if we have 5 electrical workers.
Yeah, here. That's great. Yeah. So are they elected or appointed?
That's one of the major roadblocks for us right now. They're appointed. And there's this mentality that, you know, and, you know, I don't want to knock people, but, like, there is a mentality that, you know, a bad steward is somehow worse than no steward. And, you know, you can go back and forth on that. But regardless, you know, I think the attitude is that a bad steward causes problems for the hall. And so the bottleneck is the hall who appoints the stewards.
Yeah.
Right. And so, you know, we have, you know, I was talking to someone who wants to be a steward actually today on the job site. And he got trained by the local, and he was like, yeah, I'm waiting to hear where I can go. And, you know, that's a holdup. And so genuinely, one of the things that I want to, you know, start organizing around is, like, you know, get some people who are knocking on the door here and saying, like, hey, I want to be a steward. Put me to use, you know.
Right. Yeah. People are chomping at the bit to do that. I mean, it can only help the union, you know, especially if you have a leadership that isn't resistant to people's involvement, which from what you said before seems to be the case, you know, let's jump on it. So you said the Trailblazer, you actually have a local newspaper. That's great. What's in it? I mean, is there more, I guess the question is, you know, is there debate in it? Or does it open to union members, or is it just sort of officers' information from the office?
It's basically information from the office. You'll get a business agent's report, you'll get a president's report, and you'll get a dispatcher's report. There isn't really any, there really isn't any discussion or anything going on. You know, our business agent and our president are, you know, at least politically pretty lefty. So they're always talking about, like, you know, how we need more labor rights and everything like that. But, you know, the idea that there's membership buy-in into what's going into the newspaper is, that's not a thing.
So I may know an answer to this, but just, you said that, so you haven't been there for a new contract yet, right? So, I mean, I don't know, you talk to people there a lot. Do you have a sense of how that goes? I mean, is there an informed vote? Is there a preparation going in, sort of we're gonna fight, get ready for this? Or is it sort of a very formal, it just sort of happens every 3 years and here's the new contract?
From what I have gathered, usually it is, usually the vote is a rubber stamp on what the negotiating committee has negotiated. I'm not sure if they are elected or not. I still need to figure that out. But, you know, I mean, you have stories of people being like, literally being like, you know, rousted for, like, hey, you know, after you're done with apprenticeship classes, come down to the hall and vote yes on the contract. That's not that. I wouldn't call that an informed vote.
No, it doesn't sound like it.
And you know, I don't know. I genuinely don't know how it runs, how it works in other unions. But we have a hall vote. You know, we don't have like a ballot box of like yay or nay or whatever. And you know, the people who show up to the special call meeting are the people who are voting, which you know, the kind of makes me raise an eyebrow at least. Very frequently in this union, it feels like we have this attitude of like, oh, you know, if you don't come to the meetings, then screw you. You're not getting involved, right? And yeah. That's no way to run a union. That's no way to run a democracy, period. You know, I mean, we see that in America all the time, right? You don't have the time to get an ID, well, screw you, then you're not allowed to vote. And, you know, I think that that's an attitude that really does need to be overcome, right? The activists within the union are very, like, are very condescending towards the people who are, like, you know, further out of the bullseye and like less engaged.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. So I hate to ask this question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. When was the last 520 strike?
It depends on what you mean. ULP strikes, we will strike people every now and then. You know, I feel like maybe 2 years ago we had a ULP strike. Mm-hmm. But other than that, you know, as far as contract negotiations go, at least the 90s. The 90s was when the international office started pressuring every single local to put no strike clauses in their contracts. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, just because a strike is illegal, you know, a strike is legal if you win. But no matter what, no matter how, illegal they say it is, a strike is legal if you win. But you know, the very much so, you know, we're in this attitude of, you know, strict legalism, adhere to the contract. And at that, you know, that would at least put 30 years between us and the last contract negotiation strike that we had.
Wow. Yeah. So I'm gonna start wrapping this up, but I wanted to ask about something I thought I heard you say last night in your report, but I wasn't positive. Did you say that a couple of your fellow workers from IBEW who came to the May Day March joined DSA?
No, they didn't join DSA. What we have like basically a small cadre of like, you know, some DSA people, some just more like union activist types, right? Mm-hmm. And we basically just have a small little rank and file group where we talk about like stuff that we want to get done with the union. And you know, eventually we're going to start like doing strategy meetings and everything.
Yeah.
And figuring out how to actually, you know, put a little kick in the rear end of this union and get it to start fighting for us.
Okay, but they came out to the rally, which is fantastic. That's great. All right. Well, thanks a lot, Paul. I really appreciate you. Really, I think helped sort of clue people into sort of what happens in a union, and you know, even in a union that, by AFL-CIO standards, sounds like it's a pretty good local. You know, there's a lot of work to be done, right?
All right. You know, I mean, this isn't supposed to be like, you know, kicking us down or anything. It's, you know, it's the questions we need to be asking if we're going to finally get this labor movement into a position where, you know, not only can it win like some actual demands, but, you know, maybe actually forge it into a working class movement that can finally win socialism.
Yeah. Great. Thanks a lot, man. Okay, well, that's the end of the prepared part. I think I actually managed to end it roughly on time, which is pretty good for me. I'm not really good at that. So we're going to open up to the floor. Feel free to ask any of us, me or Chris or Matt or Paul, about what we were talking about EWOC, about ROP, about the IBEW. You know, there's obviously, I gave you a quick and dirty rundown of labor law, so we're not going to have you know, whole class. But I will tell you a funny story before I open it up. some years ago, the IWW group here in Austin was putting on a worker organizing workshops, and we got Jack Getman, who's a pretty famous left labor lawyer. He was actually a professor at UT at the time. I'm sure he's retired now. He was not a spring chicken then, but he agreed to come and give us the intro to labor law. And he started his presentation by saying, when your union is getting ready to take an action, the absolute last person you want to ask if it's a good idea is a lawyer. Do what you're going to do. When you get in trouble, then come to us. But don't let lawyers dictate your strategy. All right, the floor is open. Let's maybe run a stack chat the way we usually do in these. Do you want to monitor that, Patrick? Or do you want me to?
Yeah, I can monitor the stack. So okay. If anyone would like to kick things off, the stack is open.
Oh, that's a great quote, Paul. Farrell Dobbs is one of the leaders of the Minneapolis general strike in 1934.
Okay, John, can you kick it off?
Sure, yeah. I just had, it's more of a kind of basic question, but I think it should be pretty relevant to like the next sort of phase of DSA action, but just in terms of what you refer to in the labor law section with regards specifically to like the Taft-Hartley Act, how would the PRO Act getting passed affect, you know, that kind of restrictions, the restrictions that were imposed by, you know, an act like that? And this is a question for anybody who wants to take it.
Go ahead, guys. I talked a lot.
Hey, Paul?
Yeah. So direct response, I guess. You know, so I don't have the slide in front of me, but things like solidarity strikes, mass picketing, and all these different types of strikes would be made legal by the PRO Act. And then also, as we talked about, you know, the difference between an open shop and a closed shop, that would go away. It would basically end right to work federally. Those are the two highlights that that I can remember, at least. And then, you know, going back to one of the weaknesses in the Wagner Act, the PRO Act would also actually start punishing employers for violating, for committing unfair labor practices. And, you know, there would actually be some kind of remonstration for all of these offenses that, employers do all the time.
I think Anna posted some of the bill.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, ending right to work obviously would be a huge part of it too, as well.
Was there, and I'm not as familiar with the details of it as you are, is there a part in the law, the PRO Act, that doesn't force initial contracts, but at least makes some kind of arbitration to make it easier to get one, so it's harder for employers to just dither and block until they can get the union decertified? Do you know that? No, I wasn't sure. I know that it was in EFCA, the sort of previous attempt that the PRO Act is the successor to under Obama, but I didn't know if that was part of the PRO Act or not. So,
Greg? Oh, would someone like to respond to that? It's Josh.
No. Okay.
Okay, Greg, you're up.
Yeah, real quick, something I've been thinking about a lot with the recent actions going on in labor, sort of close to us or having to do, like, for instance, The strike in Beaumont, the strike at Juiceland, the strike in Worcester, Massachusetts, which is a strike, which is a strike at a hospital, a Tenet hospital. Tenet has their headquarters in Dallas. And so like for these actions, I'm wondering like, how can DSA reach out and support these groups and these actions? Like kind of, I think the biggest thing for us is to, you know, continue to grow DSA and make it a place that workers in those unions want to gravitate towards, and also, you know, encourage our members to join shops that all have militant unions that can strike. But I'm wondering like what kind of support y'all think we can give for these kinds of actions.
So I think what New York City DSA did with the Teamsters a few months back was fantastic, where they did strike support. I don't foresee a huge picket in Texas anytime soon, but if there is, I think, we should certainly, help with strike support, whatever the workers need. In terms of like Juiceland and such, I think what happened, one of the things that happened was that we didn't really have enough familiarity with the workers before they went into strike. So that kind of colored what they thought of us, or that they even knew what we were doing. So really, I think having a greater community presence, and like I said earlier, is building trust within the community with workers is a really important thing that we need to do.
I'm wondering with the Beaumont strike, I think that might be an old OCAL local. I'm not sure, but I think it might be, which, you know, if they sort of carried on that tradition, that was a pretty radical union. That was Tony Mazzocchi's union. Of Labor Party fame. But it's really nice when, you know, you're fighting like that, if people show up to help, you know, you want to, like Chris was saying, you want to contact them and sort of build that relationship. But if you, you know, I feel like it might not be unreasonable to say, call them up and say, hey, would it, you know, if y'all are out picketing, would you like us to, you know, come out and, you know, barbecue for you next week or something. You know, when the Teamsters, you know, my union was different because it was my union doing it, you know, for the Teamsters union when they struck. But it's a huge thing to have people come out and support you. Strikes are hard. You know, we sort of look at them as a sort of romantic thing, and they are, but they're also really hard. They're hard on people, they're hard on people's families. And, you know, strike, you know, Paul pointed out there's a lockout, but in some ways that's even worse, because this isn't them taking power. This is something being done to them. Often people will picket during a lockout. And I don't know if they're doing that or not, but if they are, you know, it might be something that we could show up to. Granted, Houston's a long ways away, but as I understand it, there's a pretty good sized branch there too. And, you know, we could plan it with them.
I was going to add, I think, and this is related both to like actual union labor activity as well as sort of the labor movement in Austin in a larger sense. Sort of one of the visions I had when I first joined EWOC and wanted to start doing the local chapter here was starting to create a more formal solidarity network where not only are we aware of what other unions are doing, we know who to contact, we have relationships with them, we have a group of people that we can activate in the kinds of support that you guys are talking about, which I think DSA is a great venue for building that out, but as well as sort of a wider solidarity network in terms of right? If I'm talking to workers and they're having trouble with their landlord, right? And I can put them in touch with, you know, landlord or tenants unions, things like that, right? Or so I think DSA is well positioned and something I kind of want to help do with the labor branch to start building out a more formal solidarity network, something again that we can mobilize and activate people quickly, that we have those communication lines open, and we can help organized and unorganized workers.
What's the story with Juice Land?
Well, you know, in short, there were outside organizers who turned the organizers into anti-union. It's very funny that you said that the last thing you want to do is get a labor lawyer, because that's the thing that they're set on, is getting a labor lawyer. Crystal worked really hard on it, trying to convince them to, you know, that unions are really important, but yeah, it's very complicated. It's worth doing like a moratorium on it at some point, but yeah, it's complicated right now. But in short, it was a small group of workers, and they are anti-union.
Go ahead.
Crystal.
I was going to say, let's have Crystal talk a bit about it. If she was really involved.
I mean, I won't talk it to death because I like literally have talked it to death, but yeah, it really was what Chris described. It was like they had an outside influencer that was like an older person, and it was a group of very young kids who like had this idea, you know, they didn't know you could legally unionize in Texas and all that bullshit. And partly, so they had some older influence come in that was very anti-union and basically told them like, you're going to have to pay $300 a month in union dues. Did you know that? And they basically did the anti-bus campaign for them as their boss Googled how to union bus and then just started doing that 101. It was like wild. Yeah. So like these kids talked to every labor leader in Austin and beyond. They talked to labor lawyers at Unite Here multiple times. They talked to Mike Siegel. Mm-hmm. They had a meeting with me, Gina, and Amanda Cavazos-Weems, where they just like did not want to hear a word of what we wanted to say. Like, they just are very caught up in emotion. They have like a noble cause. And like, I think that actually Chris's idea of a postmortem of this would be amazing. We should absolutely do that, because this is like an absolute lesson in what not to do in organizing your shop floor. Like, we had people in Washington trying to help these cats and they still weren't even down for it. At the end of the day, I think that what we can take from a win from this action is like it really agitated other workers in other restaurants. And that is great news, because we do have underground campaigns here. Mm-hmm. We do have great things happening here. So like, we hope that the Juiceland workers that are currently doing this like bad campaign, like settle. And then maybe in about a year's time, we can actually get in there and really organize these workers, because the issues they have are systemic. They started in 2001. Like, I've talked to former workers. Wow. Yeah, it's definitely like a company thing that can be fixed. What we're hoping to do with ROP is hold like outside community building things. Like, that's really the role of ROP. We see ourselves nationally, like, is to build the community that will like help you win your restaurant campaign. Like, you will do outside sexual harassment bystander trainings because your boss is not going to do it for you. And we hope that that will bring workers over to us, so that what the other positive thing was that like every person that these Juiceland workers spoke to told them, go talk to Crystal and Gina there, and Chris, go talk to ROP. They're the people in town that you want to be talking to right now. And we were like, no, we already talked to them. They didn't really like us. But we should do a postmortem on it because it's honestly fascinating. People like they, it was literally a what not to do on shop floor organizing. They didn't even, when I suggested like, hey guys, like, do you want to talk to maybe some of your other coworkers, start mapping your workplace so you can actually make sure that your demands are inclusive to everyone? They were like, oh, no way. We're not doing that. Okay, well, you should talk, look at, take a look at how Amazon lost, because they were really shocked when they found out their numbers were super duper off. You know, that's going to really ruin your campaign. Yeah. Mapping is like what it is about.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, Chris. I really appreciate it. I knew bits and pieces of this, but I kind of was filling in gaps, but they were guesses. And I wish that you hadn't made me feel like the guesses were close to right, because that was what I was getting from just the little bits and pieces I was hearing and reading in the Chronicle. It sounded very disorganized, and it sounds like your experience is even worse than I had feared. But we should definitely do, I think you're totally right, is that these counterexamples are good to learn from, you know, not because we want to, you know, rub it in someone's face, but because we want to not do this in the future. And now you have this as an example, right? The next time you're talking to someone at a restaurant, you say, well, here's what they did and here's what happened. So let's definitely work on putting together a postmortem for that. I think that's a great idea. So let's see, looking at Stack. Stack looks like it's open.
I have a question for the restaurant organizing people and Josh. If are restaurants feeling particularly more pressure now in this present moment, given that some of them are experiencing worker shortages? And does that make it easier or more difficult to organize?
I'm going to pass this one to Crystal.
Yeah, I'm on a shop floor right now. And I personally think it makes it a little bit easier to organize because it takes all the agitation work out of it for me. Like, I don't need to agitate a restaurant worker. The boss is doing it for me. They're short-staffed. They're taking it out on their workers. Like, restaurant owners in this town, in my personal experience, like, I talk to workers all day and they are telling me nothing's changed. But like, everything's changed. The pandemic happened. And like, our tolerance level for putting up with the abuses we used to put up with in 2019, that time is over. We live in the era of Black Lives Matter, George Floyd. Like, the new restaurant workers coming in, they're activists. They are not putting up with any bullshit. And on my shop floor, you can really see the division in the younger workers versus the older workers. And the younger workers are who I'm trying to foster right now because they're not like jaded by the industry just yet. But restaurant managers and bosses, they're the most jaded you'll ever see because they're all promoted from within. They started as a server and then they failed up to a manager. And like, you don't even have to have a skill to be a restaurant manager. You just have to be a yes man. And you'll be the director of operations before you know it. So like, what bosses aren't feeling, what does make it harder to organize, and this is the challenge that I'm currently facing, is like, restaurant workers know, I'll just walk out, I'll have a job tomorrow, and they're doing it, and we don't want that to happen, because their next job is going to steal from them, their next job is going to abuse them. And the perfect example is this girl I talked to today. Like, she's texting me right now. She left my shop floor over basically a dishwasher was groping her on shift. HR wouldn't handle it, so she walked. Exactly. It was like unacceptable. Now, I wish she had stayed. If we had a union, we would have handled that pretty quick. But that's just not the reality. And she knew she could just walk out. So she did. After she tried to stay, HR handled it poorly. She just walked out mid-meeting. Well, she just texted me, told me she had 3 interviews today. One was at Amy's Ice Cream. I've never heard anything bad about them. I don't know. I just know she won't make money there. So that's not a good fit because they don't pay enough. It's an ice cream store. And then the other place she got the job at, well, yesterday I had a meeting with their former GM who was telling me all about their wage theft. So it's like this girl just walked into one, from one bad shop to another. Now she's 24, so she doesn't know that yet. I'll be 30. I'm 36. Thanks the Washington Post for publishing that. I know better. You know, I've been in literally the Austin restaurant industry for 12 years, you know? So I've seen it all and I know everyone. And like when I talked to her, she was like, my coworkers are just going to quit. Good. That's what they deserve. And I'm like, no, the best revenge is you form a union under the boss, because then they really can never do this again. But like, they just don't get that yet because they really don't understand what unions are yet. And that's the other challenge, is like, they're just still living in a little juice land world where they think they can go on strike and get a boss to step down. Like, that is not reality. On planet Earth, what you do is you stay, you talk to your coworkers, and you convince them that you do collective action and form a union, and you build your community around you. So it's harder, it's easier, but there's always some kind of challenge. If it's not this, it's going to be something else. You just have to always learn how to like move around it. And I'm definitely not speaking about this as an expert because I started doing this in July. So like, take what I say with a big grain of salt.
Well, I got to disagree with you because it sounds to me like we are talking. I mean, you might have been in DSA for however long you've been in DSA, but if you've been in the restaurant industry for 12 years, I think that qualifies you to be an expert.
So. Thank you. I appreciate that.
I think you're our resident. What did Chris write? T1000. Yes, exactly. So, you know, it seems to me like you're a real resource that, you know, that's what ROP needs. I mean, that's what any union organizer organization needs, is that kind of knowledge and intimate familiarity with the industry who knows everybody. So that gives me a great deal of enthusiasm. So it's about 9:00, and in respect for people's time, I think we're going to wrap up. We'll do this again